Hello, I'm Tap G.
And I'm Surfer Clock.
And welcome to What's the Attraction?
Where our work is your vacation. Welcome to the fourth of five episodes in our WTA 100 Likes Recut. Although this was the single most viewed episode at over 100 views on YouTube, this only applied to part one. The episode was still a little lengthy at nearly 20 minutes.
Hey, Surfer Clock! Great news, buddy! We're downsizing!
Wait, that's horrible! WTA can't afford these kind of cuts! Well, we can't, but...
Dude. I was referring to the episode size. That's the second time you fell for that.
Anyway, folks, we're here today to take a fresh look at the Honey, I Shrunk the Kids movie set adventure.
When Disney's Hollywood Studios opened in 1989, then known as Disney MGM Studios, it was really criticized for not having much to do. A half-day park, as it were. On top of all that, there was little to nothing for kids of any age to do. Not exactly up to Disney Park standards.
The park opened May 1st of 1989. A month and 22 days later, Disney would release a live-action movie called Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. The film would be an unprecedented success at the box office, raking in $222 million. Enough, in fact, for the film's star, Rick Moranis, to retire into relative obscurity, save for a few sequels down the road.
While undoubtedly shocked at the success of the film, Imagineers got to work, and right around a year later, on December 17th, 1990, the Honey, I Shrunk the Kids movie set adventure opened to the public.
While not a huge addition to the tiny studio park, it increased the things for kids to do factor by nearly 100%. It was first used as a diversion from the backstage studio tour while folks ate lunch during the break period. Once that tour changed to something a little closer to its current incarnation, the playground became a standalone attraction.
As you enter the play area, it's hard not to notice those giant blades of grass. Getting further in, it's apparent that you have shrunk to the same size as those kids from the movie. In addition to giant grass, you'll also notice a massive bee, giant tree trunk slides, a slide fashioned from film, and a sniffing dog's nose, and even a giant ant with a leaf sled.
Some elements were lifted directly from the movie, but some stuff is purely there to enhance the play experience. The kids in the movie never climbed through a spider web or explored ant tunnels, but both are included in the playground for the enjoyment of the young at heart.
There are other subtle touches, too. Massive fallen leaves, a giant leaky garden hose, and a slew of Hasbro brand toys at trunk and eye level.
Product placement and subtle? The two don't mix.
No.
Brought to you by the new line of Super Soaker guns.
Anyway, it's been a staple of the park since its opening, and most kids seem to enjoy it. Play is monitored by several cast members, but we here at What's the Attraction strongly discourage adults from leaving your children unattended here. In fact, it can be a lot of fun to tag right along with them and enjoy some bonding time.
There is only one entrance and one exit right next to one another. Again, monitored by a cast member. But again, still not a good idea to leave young children unattended. So, Tap G, your thoughts?
Disproportion!
Disproportion?
Disproportion.
Disproportion.
Why is the Super Soaker gun smaller than the Play-Doh can?
Yeah, that's a good question.
Why is Quark's nose barely bigger than Auntie?
Another good question.
I mean, okay, let's look at this historically. I mean, this was Disney MGM Studios back in 1990 when the in thing for Universal and Disney was to make movie parks. I'm guessing this was kind of a tribute to cheesy sets?
I don't know, but I think the ant is about the same size as it was in the film. I think it was really more of a playful adaptation, really made to be palatable to kids.
You know, speaking of Auntie, I looked up that the guy who did the noises for Auntie was none other than the legendary voice actor Frank Welker.
Frank Welker?
Yeah, and he reprised the noises for Auntie for the playground.
That's really interesting. I didn't know that.
And now you know.
Sweet.
So there's that. But the other question I have is it really does seem dated in a lot of ways.
Well, sure. It came out way back in the day.
Do kids even know what a roll of film is anymore?
Another fair question. Not unless we tell them.
True, but I mean, even if you take that out of context, I mean, the movie How I Shrunk the Kids was a very well-known movie throughout the 90s. We grew up with, we know the prefix, Honey Eye something. But I think kids today just aren't that familiar with it like we were, unless we show them to it. In fact, you actually just rewatched the movie again for your review on This Movie Is Sick, didn't you?
Yes, I did. I really enjoyed the film, and I still kind of like it, though I'm a little less, like, fascinated with maybe the first half of the film.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a lot of character building.
Yeah.
And it's actually pretty good because it helps to round out the ending.
Yeah.
And it helps to make it a decent ending for what it is.
Helps make you care for the characters who are now lost in the grass.
Yes, but the second half, I will always thoroughly enjoy the second half, and I think a lot of people enjoyed the second half. And to have that recreated as a real thing for kids to experience here at Honey, I Shrunk the Kids Playground, I think that's pretty cool.
Minus the scorpion and the River of Mud.
Yeah, the River of Mud, I don't think would have been very good.
I think a lot of people would have been like, where's Willy Wonka? Why is he not here? It's just like, wrong brown river.
Yes. Now, one thing I really do like about the playground is that it so captures the nostalgic feeling of being in the film. Another thing I really like about the playground is that the soundtrack, if you've ever listened to the soundtrack of the playground, it's actually really cool.
I never really paid attention.
It's actually from, a lot of the stuff is from early 80s, from an artist called Ray Lynch.
Did he do the music for the film?
He actually didn't, know, but it's the several of the music selections are from Ray Lynch. There's some from Tangerine Dream.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no, there's one from Tangerine Dream. And the other artist I can't seem to recall at the moment.
Oh.
But if you ever go and just, you know, over the noise of the kids, if you ever go and just, like, listen to the soundtrack of the playground, it's actually pretty cool.
Cool.
Oh, another interesting fact about it is that a couple of the tracks were also used at Epcot's Wonders of Life Pavilion.
No kidding.
Back in the day, yeah.
Cool. Overall, I like the playground. I love playgrounds in theme parks, and
sure.
I love how they can be used as a moment for adults and kids to bond. And yeah, I'm never a fan of when adults just leave them there and go off and ride the roller coaster, but, you know, yin and yang. But I think probably one of the greatest problems we have with it is the limited accessibility to it.
Yes, I was actually going to mention that earlier. It's not like you can bring wheelchairs and the electric convenience vehicles into the playground, but there are actually certain areas they cannot access. I'm surprised it really wasn't cited for this because of the Americans with Disabilities Act.
Yeah.
The sniffing dog's nose is actually up several flights of stairs, and there's no ramp to actually get there.
No, but I maybe they could add a ramp or two, but I think they would need a little room to expand in order to do that, and it's kind of closed off between a few buildings and the restaurant.
Studio Catering Company.
Yeah.
And there's also that, you know, if you're in a wheelchair, if you're bound to that wheelchair, you actually cannot go down the film can slide.
Oh, yeah.
Because that is also up at least one flight of stairs.
Yeah.
So there's a few things that, you know, folks who have limited mobility really can't enjoy.
Sadly.
And to me, that kind of knocks it down a couple pegs.
Ultimately, I give this a 3 out of 5.
I'm going to go ahead and give it a 2.5 out of 5. So that's a 2.5 out of 5 from Surfer Clock and a 3 out of 5 from Tap G.
As we were saying before, although it's fun for all ages, it's still not a good idea to leave young children unattended. And in fact, children younger than 7 can't enter the playground by themselves. They must be accompanied by someone at least 14 years of age or older. Those traveling in scooters or electric convenience vehicles, those ECVs, are welcome to enter, as well as those traveling in wheelchairs. But please bear in mind that the play surface made from recycled rubber can be a bit tough to traverse. Also, some areas of the playground have stairs, but no ramps for wheelchairs or scooters to go up.
Fans of the first Honey film will find the oversized props rather nostalgic and fun to be able to actually see and interact with. Families will find the play area great for blowing off some steam, and it has the potential for some great photo opportunities. Kids from ages 5 to 11 will have the most fun here, while those any older will find it either dull or, hey, maybe it's a good resting place. Well, I think that just about does it. Thanks for joining us.
I just realized something. We forgot to mention the giant cookie.
Oh, what?
Quiet.
Did you hear that?
Hear what?
That thump. It happened when you almost mentioned the giant cookie.
Oh, cookie! Me want cookie! Nom, 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 nom.
Whoa, Cookie Monster, please, stop! No, not the computer, not the computer!
Nom, 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 nom.